Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents High, Wide, and Lonesome, Growing Up on the Colorado Frontier, by Hal Borland. Narrated by Peter Lerman. Foreword. By an accident of time and place, I grew up on an American frontier. I was born in 1900. 96 years to the day after Lewis and Clark left St. Louis on their expedition across the newly acquired Louisiana Purchase. But my formative years were spent under circumstances not far different from those my great-grandfather knew in western Pennsylvania a century earlier, when Conestoga wagons were still hauling freight over the Alleghenies into the raw, new Ohio country. In that sense, I was born old. I am a kind of bridge between an almost legendary past and a fabulous but often worrisome present. In a way, I am my own grandfather, or even my great-grandfather. In terms of social history, I have lived close to 150 years, simply because I grew up on an island of isolation in eastern Colorado. As a result of strange eddies in the migration of a restless people, eastern Colorado and western Kansas were virtually untouched by the whole 19th century. After Lewis and Clark, the trappers and traders ranged the whole area from the Mississippi River to the Pacific coast. Then the army, following the trappers' trails and often guided by the trappers, explored that country. In 1836, a ragged frontier army won freedom for Texas. A decade later, another motley army won a war for California. Gold discoveries set off a series of mass migrations to California, to Montana, to the Denver area. The Mormons made their stark trek to Utah, not for gold, but for land and freedom from persecution. And after the Civil War, the Texans, cattle poor and rawhide tough, trailed their longhorn herds north across hundreds of hostile miles to the railroad pushing its way westward across Kansas. In their haste, these rushes and treks and trailings detoured or leapfrogged vast areas, some of which became virtual islands of isolation in a shallow sea of settlement. Those islands, isolated geographically and doubly victims of the time and culture lag, east to west, which was so pronounced before the era of national magazines, newspapers, and radio, became our last frontier. Eastern Colorado was one of those islands. That high, wide, and lonesome land is roughly 200 miles square, an arid, treeless, short grass upland with few live streams. To the north lies the Platte River, along which emigrants followed the Oregon Trail. To the south lies the Arkansas River and the old Santa Fe Trail. To the east is central Kansas, long accepted as the western limit of feasible agriculture. To the west is the barrier of the Rocky Mountains. No major emigrant trail ever crossed that area. It was too dry, and the Indians were too fanatically hostile. For years, a large part of it was an Indian reserve, and it was the range of one of the last great buffalo herds. In 1877, the year after Colorado was admitted into the Union, President Rutherford B. Hayes called those high plains an unsalable desert, unfit for human habitation, and recommended that it be set aside as a grazing reserve, to be tamed by the stockmen if they ever needed the grass enough to undertake the job. His recommendation was ignored. But the area's character had changed very little when my father decided, in the spring of 1910, that he wanted to take a homestead there. We arrived on that unsalable desert by a route that sums up a good deal of frontier history. My father's people came from Scotland to America before the Revolution and settled in New York State. After the Revolution, they moved to the frontier in western Pennsylvania. My great-grandfather, who came to be known as Old Will, was taken from there to Ohio as a child. In young manhood, he moved, with his wife and basic possessions, to frontier Indiana. His son, my grandfather, who was known as Young Will, in turn moved west, fording streams and hacking his way through the forest. But by then, the frontier was moving swiftly westward. Young Will went all the way to Nebraska. He settled not far from a secondary trail which crossed the Missouri River at St. Joseph, Missouri, and angled north to the Oregon Trail on the Platte. Young Will Borland, my grandfather, was only casually a farmer. He was by trade a blacksmith and millwright. After a few years on the frontier farm, he moved to Sterling, a new community on the Nemaha Creek, and set up his forge and built a mill. He was a small bull of a man, 5'6" and close to 200 pounds. He had lost one eye in a boyhood accident, but he was a crack shot with a rifle. He made nails and hinges for the village church, built wagons that would last a farmer's lifetime, fed, clothed, and schooled a big family, and died in his 50s. Two of his sons became blacksmiths. Two became railroad men. One became a teacher, one the local sexton, and one an editor. My father, still another Will Borland, was the editor. He started to learn the blacksmith's trade, but after a year of it, he walked out of the shop and apprenticed himself to the village printer. He became a master printer and eventually a part owner of the weekly newspaper where he had learned his trade. But he too had the westward urge and dream of his father and his father's father. So we went to Colorado that spring of 1910 and settled on a homestead almost 30 miles south of the Platte Valley town of Brush. By 1910, railroad promotion and the Depression of 1907 had persuaded a good many marginal farmers in the Midwest that free land, even on the forbidding high plains, was worth a gamble. They were willing to bet Uncle Sam, as the saying went, that they could live on those dry plains 5 years, later reduced to 3, without starving out. If they won the bet, the land was theirs. If they lost, all they lost was their time and a little labor. So there was a fringe of homestead settlement all around that arid area when we arrived. My father chose a homestead out beyond that fringe. Our homestead was as far from Brush, both in distance and in travel time, as Hillsdale, Ohio had been from Chillicothe in my great-grandfather's day. It was as far from my grandfather's homestead near Vesta, Nebraska, had been from Nebraska City. In terms of horse travel, the means they used and the means we used, it was a good 5 hours each way, even in good weather. In spring mud or winter snow, it was a long all-day trip each way. There were telephones in our day, but the nearest one was 12 miles from the homestead. So was the nearest post office. The nearest doctor was 30 miles from us, and our closest neighbor was 2 miles away. Looking back from this age of atomic power, our life on the homestead seems almost as strange as life in medieval England. Yet the grandfathers would have been at home there. They pioneered in timbered country, but the plains would not have baffled them for long. Lacking logs, they would have built a sod house, as we did. Lacking firewood, they would have burned cow dung and sheep dung, as we did. They would have made do with what they had until they could provide better. They would have hunted their own meat, ground their own corn, tended their own sick, buried their own dead, and persisted. And all without heroics, with only that dogged determination, that persistence in the dream, which is a bright golden thread through all of America's history. In a sense, this book is a fragment of American history. It is the story of the frontier and the pioneering I knew. As a nation, during my own lifetime, we have had to face bitter questions about our purposes and our basic philosophies. Many of the answers, when we face the question squarely, lead back to the frontiers, to men and women in a wilderness, whether it is a bleak Atlantic shore, a savage woodland, or a lonely, distant prairie. To men and women stubbornly trying to make a safe home, security for themselves, and a better world for their children. Colonial New England is far away and long ago, and Dan Boone's Kentucky is a misty legend. But the Old West is just over the horizon, a frontier which, in many ways, summed up three centuries of American pioneering and growth toward maturity. Reaching for a remembrance of it, trying to understand this heritage of ours, we sometimes catch only false heroics and false melodrama, but now and then we do capture enough of its reality to recognize our enduring purposes. No matter where we came from or when, the pioneers were our rootstock, our source, our beginnings. They shaped the pattern for America. H.B., 1956. 1. When Father and I started out that late April morning, it was like the dawn of creation, so sweet and clean and crisply damp cool. All along the first 2 miles south from the town, the blackbirds in the big cottonwoods ka-cheed among the jade-flake leaves, leaves no bigger than a ground squirrel's ear. The blackbirds themselves were like gems, jet set with ruby and gold, the red wings and the yellow heads all ka-cheeing in the sun not half an hour high. And in the roadside alfalfa, silvery blue-green in new leaf and dew, was a jackrabbit in from the sandhills for breakfast, the sun making his long black-tipped ears pink as rose quartz. It was all spring and new beginnings, a morning to be alive and laughing. I wanted to laugh and shout when the jackrabbit in the alfalfa swiveled his ears, stood on his haunches, knee-high to a tall man, and wriggled his nose at us. Then Father did laugh, and Dick and Shorty broke into a trot, snorting and eager and full of life, and the rabbit hopped away. The wagon, loaded with lumber and roofing paper and sections of galvanized well casing, jolted on the gravel road, creaking and rattling. Father let the horses trot a little way, then drew them down to a walk again and handed the lines to me while he rolled a Bulldorm cigarette. Already, Nebraska was back east, and we were Coloradoans. Father, who had been a printer since he was 14, was going to be a ranchman, or at least a farmer. "If I'm ever going to make a change," he'd said 2 months ago, "I'd better make it now, or I'll wake up some morning and find that I'm an old man." Father was almost 32 years old, so he came to Colorado alone from the little Nebraska town where he was born, less than 30 miles from the Missouri River, and he found the land he wanted and filed on it as a homestead. He went back to Nebraska, sold his share of the weekly newspaper, sold the house where he lived, and told Mother and me we'd move just as soon as winter was over. Winter began to break up in March, hurried as though just for us by an early spring. Mud and melt crept along the Missouri River bottomlands and up Nemaha Creek, and Father helped us with the first packing. Then he left the rest of the packing to Mother and me and came to Colorado to rent the little greenhouse and brush for a temporary home, to buy a team and wagon and a couple of cows and a dozen chickens. He even set 2 broody hens so Mother would have a flock of chicks for summer frying. And 10 days ago, Mother and I came out to brush, 18 hours on the cindery green plush train, eating from the big box of picnic food, napping in the stiff-backed seats, talking to the friendly conductor and brakeman. The brakeman said to me, "Why, at almost 10, you're big enough to ride a bronco and shoot a coyote." And I couldn't wait to get to Colorado. Now we were on the way to the homestead, Father and I. Mother had seen us off, breakfasted and eager. Father had said, "We'll be back within a week or so, 10 days at most. We'll get a house up and dig a well, then we'll come back for you." And she had kissed us both and waved goodbye, slim and dark-haired and a little misty-eyed. Mother would be 29 in the fall. She was still standing there in the dooryard, watching, her hands wrapped in her apron, when we turned the corner at the depot and waved. She waved to us, then turned and went back to the little greenhouse, and we headed south along the road lined with tall cottonwoods just leafing out. 2 miles from town, we came to the end of the cottonwood lane. Ahead was the first range of sandhills. We turned east, skirting them. We were climbing out of the Platte Valley, going toward the high flatlands. Behind us, the valley was lush with trees and irrigated fields. Ahead, where we were going, the hills rolled gently all the way to the horizon without a tree in sight. We skirted the sandhills another mile to the east, then turned south again, and the hard road ended. The horses began to strain as the heavily laden wagon's wheels bit into the sand track. I watched the front wheel on my side, the left, as it turned in the sand, felly deep. The sand lifted with the wheel and fell back in a little cascade that glistened in the sun and made a soft, singing hiss. The hub rattle was muffled. Only the puffing of the horses and the creak of harness were louder than the singing hiss of the sand at the wheels. I looked south and asked, "Is that where we're going, to that hill?" "Farther than that," Father said. And when we had crossed the next hollow, there was a new farthest hill. We were going farther than that one, too, much farther. We crossed the sandhill strip, and we were on hard road again. The sun was halfway toward noon. The horses were sweating, and the smell of sweat and warm leather was a Nebraska smell. It was a grandpa smell, Mother's father, who was a farmer and teamster. I would always remember him for the smell that was upon him, a clean farm smell of hay and horses, not a barn smell. Grandpa was a gentleman, a man who never had a cross word for horses or dogs or small boys. The other grandfather, Father's father, I never knew. He died before I was born. He was a blacksmith and a millwright. There was a profile picture of him that hung in an oval frame in Grandma Borland's house. It showed only one side of his face and one eye. He lost the other eye as a boy. He had a face like Father's, except that Grandpa Borland had a full black mustache. All grandfathers had mustaches. Grandpa Klinneberg had a brown one, except when he'd been hauling flour for the mill. Then it was white, and so was his hair. Sometimes Father told stories about Grandpa Borland, but not this morning. We topped another rise, and I pointed again to the farthest hill in sight. "Farther than that one?" Father laughed. "That hill is this side of Gary, and Gary's just about halfway there." So I watched the meadowlarks on the fence posts at the side of the road, saw the yellow of their breasts and the spotted brown of their backs and the lengths of their bills. I watched the funny way they flew on their stubby wings. As I listened to their songs, it seemed they were saying, "This is the time to see the world," and "Hello there, boy." And I watched the striped-backed little ground squirrels and asked Father what they were. He told me, and I said they couldn't be squirrels because squirrels along the Nemaha Creek back in Nebraska had long bushy tails. These, I said, were squinnies. And Father said, "You'll see a lot of squinnies." It was 11 o'clock when we reached Gary. Gary wasn't really a town. It was a store and a post office, a big rambling frame building with a wide porch and a long hitch rack. Father tied the team at the hitch rack, and we went inside. It was dark and cool and smelled of coffee and leather and calico and coal oil. Tom McDowell, the tall, lean, leisurely storekeeper, wore a blue work shirt and a vest open down the front. He drawled when he said, "Warm morning for April, ain't it?" Then he glanced out the big front window, saw our wagon and its load, and he asked, "Homesteaders?" Father said, "Yes, we're going down in the corner of the county, just going out to build the house." Mr. McDowell said, "Well, Good luck. That's down on John Garrity's range, isn't it? I was edging down the long brown counter, looking at the yellow coils of lariat rope, the leather work gloves, the bibless overalls, the high-heeled boots hanging in pairs from the ceiling, at the few bolts of calico on the shelves, the rolls of table oilcloth, the square, slant-topped, lacquered bins of coffee and tea, the glass-topped bins of ginger snaps and pink iced cookies. There was a glassed case with boxes of cigars and bags of smoking tobacco, and a pile of long brown slabs of chewing tobacco. And at the back of the store, in a corner, was a cubbyhole of a post office with its barred window and its squares of mailboxes. Beside the mailboxes stood big burlap bags of Mexican beans and white 100-pound sacks of sugar. Father was buying cheese and crackers and sardines. Mr. McDowell was saying, "That's down south of Garrity's main camp, up at the head of Ketchum Holler." "I don't know that name," Father said. "That's the big valley just west of the school section," Mr. McDowell said. "They used to use it to hold the herd when they had Roundup, the big ranches." "I guess that's it," Father said. "We're just west of the school section on Section 17. Mr. McDowell nodded and put the things in a paper sack. "Good hayland in there. Well, I'll probably be seeing you some more. Expecting any mail?" "Not yet," Father said. He paid the bill and we went back to the wagon. There was a watering trough beside the store, so we watered the horses before we drove on. 3 more miles south, past a few farms and alfalfa fields, and we came to another range of sand hills. We drove to the top of the first hill, pulled out of the main track, and unhitched the horses. Father slipped the bits from their mouths and set out a tin pail for each of them with a couple of quarts of oats. We sat in the shade of the wagon, and Father opened the package of cheese. He cut a slice with his pocket knife, laid it on a big square cracker, and handed it to me before he opened the can of sardines. I took a bite, caught the cracker crumbs with my tongue, and sucked the warm, tangy cheese and felt the crispness of the cracker. I held it in my mouth, just tasting it, before I chewed it. Father cut another slice of the cheese, put it on another cracker, and lifted a mustard-drippy sardine on his knife blade. He put the sardine on the cheese and handed the whole wonderful thing to me. Crisp cracker, tingly cheese, and mustardy sardine. It was even better than Nemaha Creek catfish and bread and butter. The oozy mustard filled your mouth. There was the crunchy taste of cracker and the warm sardine taste, and there was the clinging cheese taste, all combined. Cheese and crackers are good food on any hilltop. Cheese and crackers and mustard sardines are a banquet. We banqueted till there wasn't a crumb of cheese left or a drip of mustard in the sardine can. Then we lay in the shade under the wagon and watched 2 sand lizards no longer than my hand, lizards with green and sand-colored backs and yellowish-white bellies and white throats that pulsated as they breathed. The horses snuffled. There was a breath of cool air in the shade, and somewhere in the distance, a hawk on the wing screamed a faint, echoing challenge. Off to the south was another high hill, faint green and gleaming sand gold in the sun. I sat up and pointed, and Father smiled and said, before my question came, "Still farther than that, son." We hitched the horses to the wagon and went on. There were no more fences now. On a distant hill there was a house, a lonely house without even a barn. Then, as we drove on and on, that last house was out of sight. The road had become a trail, 2 faint ruts in the greening sand grass. Then we came to the far edge of the sand hills, and hard land was under us again. There we left the wagon tracks, turned southwest onto a high flatland. We climbed a long, gentle slope and were alone in a vastness and a distance that were like nothing I had ever seen or imagined. In all directions, I could see the horizon. Not a hill between that interrupted the smooth, round, bowl rim of blue. It was like being a very tiny ant on a table under Mother's very biggest mixing bowl, a blue and silver bowl and a tablecloth all greeny tan and full of little wrinkles. Father drew up the horses for a moment and just sat and looked. There was an expression on his face that I had seen only once before, the first time he came home from out here and told Mother and me about the homestead he had filed on. But now it was even brighter, that look, and it had a kind of smile deep inside that didn't show on his lips but only in his blue eyes. I looked at him and I looked again at the distance, and I felt a kind of smile inside myself and a sense of awe that made me not want to say a word. It was so big, so vast, so new, so wonderful. Father took a deep breath and we drove on. It was like driving into a world nobody had ever seen before except God. A world God had just made, like the world in the Bible before there was an Adam or an Eve. Even the sounds were all new. The hub rattle of the wagon was muted in the deep mat of curled buffalo grass. The creak of the harness was not much louder than the squeak of a cricket in your pocket. We went on across the upland and came to a prairie dog town where the grass was thinned away and there were hundreds of pockmark holes and pimple mounds where the brown little prairie dogs, fatter and bigger than Nebraska squirrels, sat and yipped at us and jerked their skinny tails and dived down their burrows when the wagon came near. We came to a broad, shallow lake, melt from the winter snow and drain from the spring rain, that would shrink to a little mud hole in another month or two. It hardly looked like water. It was so clear. And under the water, the grass was growing, much greener than the flat all around it. Ducks were there, scores of teal and mallards and even canvasbacks, swimming on the clear water over the green grass as though they were swimming in the air. And around the edges were brown curlew and snipe, with their long, grotesque beaks and fat, stubby bodies, and killdeers, with their black coats and white shirt fronts, running along in the shallows and bobbing and leaping into the air and crying, "Killdeer, killdeer, killdee-dee," as they flew a little way and settled again. We came close to the water and the ducks quacked in excitement and flailed the water and rose on beating wings, dripping so much that for a moment there was a flash of rainbow in the spray. They rose and circled and came back to land with outstretched feet and cupped wings in a new rush of spray. Then the lake was behind and the meadowlarks were singing, "Hello there, boy!" And little horned larks went spiraling up right under the horses' noses, singing as they flew high in circles. And when we came down a little slope into Hidden Hollow, there was a rush of small hoofs and a flash of white rump patches as a herd of pronghorn antelope, surprised at their grazing, bounded away, stiff-legged and breathtakingly swift. They ran to the next hilltop, circled, came back behind us, and, full of curiosity, followed the wagon for half a mile. Mid-afternoon, and we saw another wagon coming toward us. Just the sight of it was startling. I felt the way Robinson Crusoe felt when he saw the footprints in the sand. We had been all alone in this tremendous world, and now there was someone else. The wagon was drawn by a black team, a shiny, black, arch-tailed team of horses, and on the wagon seat was a little man with a round face and stocky body, and a grin that was a welcome itself. He drew alongside and stopped and shouted, "Hello, strangers, where are you heading?" Father said we were going out to our homestead to build a house. "Where are you located?" the little man asked. "Section 17, Father said. North half of 17. Good, the little man exclaimed. I'm just a couple of miles from you. My name's Farley, Jake Farley. He reached in the pocket of his bibbed overalls. I've got a house built, and you can stay there till you get a roof up. I'm going to town a week or so. Here's the key. He tossed it over, and Father caught it. Make yourself at home. And Mr. Farley relaxed the lines, and his black team took off at a fast trot, the empty wagon rattling over the grass. We drove on, now following Mr. Farley's wagon tracks, the only mark on that whole expanse of grass. The hills were covered with buffalo grass, or buffalo mixed with grama, and the draws, or valleys, were carpeted with bluestem. Here and there were clumps of yucca with their stiff, evergreen bayonet leaves, and now and then we came to a hollow where sheep had grazed the grass away and cut it out with their sharp hooves, and sagebrush had taken over, sage and greasewood. And here and there were big beds or scattered clumps of cactus, the flat-leafed gray grizzly ones full of vicious thorns, and the greener, less-spined prickly pears. But even the yucca and the sagebrush and greasewood and the cactus were lost in the vastness of grass. The highest sagebrush wasn't as high as the hubs on the front wheels of the wagon. Good soil, Father said. That grass has been here forever. Even the sagebrush doesn't do too well, because sage likes poor soil. The grass takes over even from the sage when it gets half a chance. At last, we came to a hill that sloped down to Mr. Farley's house, and we were at the end of the day's journey. Mr. Farley's house was set on the gentle hillside above a valley of bluestem, already ankle-high with new growth. It was a long, low building, still new pine yellow and smelling of pitch. Just down the hillside was a pump on a little wooden platform, a green pump so new the paint was still on the handle. We unlocked the door in one end of the house, the end with two windows. There was a partition across the middle. One end, the end we went in, was the house. It had a cook stove and an iron bed with brown blankets over a blue-striped mattress and a bench built under one window to eat from and a bench beside it to sit on. The other end of the building was the barn, with big doors and no windows and no floor, and a manger built against the partition. We unhitched the horses and put them in the barn. Father took our box of groceries into the house, and I went for a pail of water. Father built a fire in the stove with cow chips, dried cow dung, from the pile in the corner behind the stove. He opened a can of beans and fried a pan of bacon, and we sat down at the bench beneath the window and ate our supper. The sun set. We grained the horses, we walked to the top of the hill west of the house, and Father pointed to the third hill beyond and said, "It's over there, son. That's where our homestead is." We stood there several minutes, looking. Father undoubtedly was thinking of Nebraska, of the job he had given up, the hometown he had left, the warnings spoken and unspoken that had accompanied the goodbyes. A man with a job was supposed to stick to it, and a man in business for himself was honored and respected. For a man who left school at the age of 13, Father had done well. One of his brothers, I learned long later, had said he was a fool to pack up and leave. But then he had been called foolish to quit the blacksmith shop and become a printer. He had gone his own way, following his own dream. And now that dream had turned to the land, to land of his own in a new country. He had worked 19 years for someone else. Even as part owner of the paper back home, he had been under a boss, the editor who taught him the printer's trade, and who would, as long as they worked together, always be the boss. He wanted to own himself, be his own boss, work out his own destiny. These things must have been heavy in his mind, as well as a sense of responsibility for a wife and a son who had been uprooted from home, friends, and security. He had moved from one job to another the 11 years he had been married, had lived and worked in half a dozen places, including Omaha and Nebraska City, before he returned to his hometown. But always it had been a move from a good job to a better one, and always there had been a weekly pay envelope. Now he had quit a job to move to a new land, to take his chances there. But it was his choice, his and mother's. We watched the flare of the sunset and we looked out over the endless rolling plains. Then we went back down the hill, and even I felt that Nebraska was a long, long way from there. I looked at the horizon to the east, but I couldn't see beyond the plains. In the eastern sky, maybe half as far away as Nebraska, was a long, thin cloud, all pink and lavender, with reflected sunset. I wondered if they could see that cloud in Nebraska. We went down the hill, and Father lit the coal oil lamp in the bracket over the table. The horses, just beyond the partition, were eating hay. I could hear the crunch, crunch as they ate, and old Dick snuffled as loud as though he was right there in the room with us. "Tired, son?" Father asked. "You should be. So am I. It's been a long day, and we'll have a busy day tomorrow. Let's turn in." I sat on the bed and took off my shoes. I unbuckled my overalls and unbuttoned my blouse, thinking that next year I would be old enough to wear shirts instead of blouses, shirts like Father's that you had to take off over your head. Father stood at the doorway, looking out at the dusk. "Your grandpa," he said, talking half to me and half to himself, "went all the way from Indiana to Nebraska in a covered wagon, with an ox team. He took a homestead over near Vesta, built a house and a mill, and fought wolves and Indians. Your grandpa was a crack shot, even if he did have only one eye. He used to shoot deer from his cabin door, they say. And they say he killed an Indian once with just his hammer and a hook-nosed hook knife. I guess it's in the blood to keep moving west, but of all his kids, I'm the only one who got west of Nebraska." He turned to me, still sitting on the bed in my underclothes. "Get under the covers, son. I suppose you'll grow up and move on, too." He sat down on the bench and took off his shoes. He sat there, wriggling his toes in his black cotton socks. He looked at me. "Your name should have been Will, too, like mine and your grandfather's and his father's. Kind of slipped up, I guess, when we got to you. Your great-grandfather was from Ohio, born in western Pennsylvania, but they moved to Ohio when he was a baby. When he grew up, he moved to Indiana. That must have been back in the 1830s or 40s. And now we're away out here in Colorado." He yawned and stood up and blew out the light, then came over and got into bed with me. I hugged him. "Lonesome, son?" he asked. "Miss your mother?" I did, but I said no. I snuggled against him and drew up my knees and closed my eyes. Just beyond the head of the bed, old Dick was snuffling and Shorty was eating hay and rattling his halter rope against the manger. Later, much later, I wakened. Outside, a whole pack of wolves were howling, howling and snapping and snarling right there at the door. I was in Nebraska, and there was a pack of wolves, and Grandpa Borland wasn't anywhere around to kill them with his hammer and his farrier's knife. I wanted to cry out, but I couldn't. Then the wolves were quiet for a moment, and I heard old Dick snuffle. I knew where I was, right here in Mr. Farley's cabin in Colorado, miles and miles from town. I was alone here in this house, and it was dark, and there were the wolves again, howling and trying to get in the door. I was frozen with fright. Then the wolves were quiet, and I heard Father's deep, slow breathing, almost a snore. I forced a hand to reach out and clutch him. He wakened. The wolves were howling again, I was crying. Father sat up. Son, wake up. You're having a bad dream. I clung to him, sobbing. The wolves, I whispered. Father put an arm around me and listened. Then he laughed. Those aren't wolves, son. They're just coyotes. Two coyotes can make more noise than a dozen tomcats. They won't hurt you. I listened, and they weren't wolves, and they weren't at the door. They were coyotes up on the hill. The panic eased away. We lay down again. Father put his arm around me, and, knowing security, I went to sleep again. 2. We left Jake Farley's cabin the next morning to the sound of meadowlarks and with the bright sun of a new and wonderful day. We drove over the hills and across the flats, and jackrabbits leaped from the bunch grass and went galloping into the distance. One of the jacks looked as big as the antelope we had seen the day before. He wasn't, of course, but Father said he must weigh at least 10 pounds. He ran in great leaps, and every sixth or eighth leap he went higher than before and turned his head and looked back at us. We drove 2 miles west and came to the long slope that was the east side of Ketchum Holler. The broad valley began just there to our left and wound in a big sweep to the north. It was so deep that the morning shadow still lay on the blue stem at the bottom. Beyond, to the west, another long slope marked the far side, and at the top of the slope, the land flattened out again in a high tableland. We paused on the hillside, and Father said, "There it is, son. That's our land. Our east boundary runs along the far edge of the valley. Our land lies east and west, half a mile wide north and south, and a mile long. A half section, 320 acres of these old plains." I had no conception of acreage or distance. To me, that whole expanse of hillside across the valley and the tableland beyond were ours. Father felt a kinship with the plains, but to me they were a personal possession. What are the boundaries of boyhood anyway? That land, as far as I could see, belonged to me. The school section, with its great beds of cactus, were to become mine, and so were the flats off to the south, with their huge prairie dog town. So was the whole of Ketchum Holler, even John Garrity's big sheep camp, where the prickly poppies grew lush in summer, and the doves haunted the empty sheds in winter. So were the sand hills, still farther to the north. The boundaries of boyhood, as I knew them for a time, were that thin, distant line of the horizon. And even that did not bound the dreams and the imagination. Long later, when I first saw the red stone house where Daniel Boone was born, in the red hills of Pennsylvania, I understood why he had to go and see far places. That red stone house was set in a cup of hills, every one a challenge. Those who live with a far horizon in their boyhood are never again bound to a narrow area of life. They may bind themselves, but that is a different matter. As we went on down the slope and around a shoulder of the hill, we came in sight of a windmill, the tall, four-legged tower, the big, many-vaned wheel, and the silvery fan. Beside the tower was a low, broad, galvanized watering tank. It was John Garrity's windmill, at his upper camp. Nearby were half a dozen big brown squares, the manure beds where the sheep pens had stood last season. Garrity leased the school section as a base for his upper camp, and the flock base there grazed all the hills around. The windmill wasn't running. It had been shut off and the pump pulled last fall, when the board panel pens were taken away for the winter. Soon they would be back, as soon as lambing was over, and the mill would be running again. We drove past the quiet mill and the empty tank and on across the valley. The windmill, Father had been told, was several hundred yards east of the section line. We drove a little way up the farther slope and were sure we were on our own land. We got down and explored the hillside on foot. The buffalo grass, just beginning to show spears of green through its curled brown mat, was a thick carpet. Cattle had been there this spring, for there were cow chips everywhere, and there were bleached bones, buffalo bones, and a few buffalo skulls with appealing dark gray horns still on their bony cores. The blue stem in the valley was ankle high and green as young rye. There wasn't a tree, a shrub, or a bush in sight. We hadn't seen a tree since we left the farms near Gary, and even there, there were cottonwood that had been planted near the homes. Coming down from the high flatland to the west was a shallow draw that widened as it reached Ketchum Holler. Father and I walked up the north side of this draw. Father was appraising, talking aloud to himself. A house here on the south slope will have the hill at its back for shelter in the winter. Water should be fairly shallow for the well here at the edge of the draw. We went up the hillside a little way to a flat little benchland. There on the bench was an old buffalo wallow full of rainwater, a saucer-like hollow 10 feet across and a foot and a half deep. Buffalo once had wallowed in the mud there to drive off the flies and gnats. But in the years since the last buffalo were killed, the wallow had grassed over. As with the lake on the flats, the grass under the faintly brown water was bright green. Father cupped a handful and tasted it. "It's all right," he said, and I got down on my belly and drank from the pool itself. It tasted like rainwater. "Bring the team and the wagon," Father said. "We'll build the house right here." I brought the wagon, and we unhitched the horses and unharnessed them and hobbled them so they wouldn't wander too far. We put down boards on the grass beside the wagon for a floor and leaned boards against the wagon for a lean-to roof. We had a camp. We stowed the blankets and the box of groceries in it, and Father took a spade and made a plain-style fireplace, a narrow trench with the sod piled on each side to support the skillet. Then we gathered a pile of dry cow chips, and we had our camp complete. Father squinted at the sun and got his directions straight, and then he cut a stake and drove it in for one corner of the house. I held the tape, and we laid out the other corners, square with the sun. The house was going to be 14 feet wide and 20 feet long, with a narrow end to the north and with the door facing the east and the sunrise. When we had it all laid out, Father took the post-hole auger and dug a hole at each corner. In each hole, we set a split cedar post, 4 feet down and well tamped in, to anchor the house against the wind. Then we laid out the sills and the floor joists. Father nailed them into place, and I held the corner studs while he nailed them to the cedar post. Noon came. We ate cold sandwiches and drank water from the buffalo wallow. We worked all afternoon, I fetching the saw, the square, the nails, holding the studs while Father toenailed them to the sills. By sunset, we had a rough framework up and braced, the beginnings of a house. Father put down his hammer and flexed his fingers. Shadows were already darkening Ketchum Holler. I was almost too tired to stand. Father looked at me and at the shelter there beside the wagon. Then he looked at the horses, and he asked, "Well, son, shall we catch up Dick and Shorty and leave the wagon here and ride back over to Farley's cabin for the night?" He waited for an answer, leaving it to me. I looked at the deepening shadows and at the skeleton of the house and at the makeshift lean-to open at both ends. I thought about the little greenhouse in town and about Mother and about the coyotes last night. I slowly said, "Let's stay here." "Fine," said Father. I said, "I'm not afraid of coyotes." I said it very firmly and resolutely. Father peeled potatoes and set bacon to fry. Then he sent me for a pail of water. It was getting dark. The buffalo wallow was at least 50 yards from the lean-to. I walked all the way there. Then I began to see shadows moving, which weren't shadows at all, or anything but imagination. I sloshed the pail quickly into the water, got it two-thirds full, and ran. I ran halfway back, then walked, my heart pounding. Father had opened a can of beans. He took the pail of water from me without a word, started to pour some into the coffee pot, then reached for a flour sack dish towel. He held the towel over the lip of the pail and strained the water into the pot. Then he showed me a dozen tiny wiggling things in the dish towel. "Wiggle tails," he said. "I guess you might call them mosquito tadpoles because they'll grow into mosquitoes."
"Do they bite?" I asked.
Father laughed. "Not till they turn into mosquitoes. I've probably drunk a quart of them one time or another. But they don't make the coffee taste any better. Next time, push the top order aside and dip the pail deep. The wigglers are always on top." It was full dark before we ate. Our only light was the last glow of the cow chip fire and the faint gleam of the early stars. Far off across the valley, a turtle dove was hoo-hooing. I was almost too weary to eat, but Father finished everything. He wiped out the bean pan with a slice of bread. Then he poured another cup of coffee and rolled a cigarette. I sat there beside him while he smoked.
"Asleep, son?" he finally asked.
"No."
"Tired?"
"Mm-hmm." He tossed the cigarette into the fire trench. "Let's go bring in the horses for the night, just to be sure they're here in the morning." As we left the lean-to, almost all the stars were out, bright as candles. The night wasn't really black at all, with all the stars. The far hill, the other side of Ketchum Holler, was a black shadow. But the faint tan of the grass here on our hillside was almost shimmery, catching and reflecting the starlight. I could see the horses, heads up, watching us as we approached. The night wasn't strange or frightening. It was home, our new home. I let go of Father's hand and walked alone. We caught the horses and took off the hobbles and led them back to the wagon and tied their halter ropes to the wheels. As we went around the wagon to the lean-to, Father pointed to the sky. "See the dipper up there? Always high, this time of year," and tipped over the bowl upside down. I found the Big Dipper. "There are the pointers, those two stars at the end of the bowl. Down where they are pointing, halfway to the horizon, is the North Star." I found the North Star. Father looked at the framework of the house outlined against the hillside and measured it against the North Star. "Just about right," he said. "Just about true north and south." We went into the lean-to and sat on the blanket pallet to take off our shoes. "Same stars we had in Nebraska," Father said. "Even out here you needn't ever get lost if you can see the sun or the stars. You'll know your directions. You can always count on the sun and the North Star." We crawled between the blankets. Father put an arm around me. I lay there for several minutes. Then from far down Ketchum Holler came a faint yip, 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 yor, yip, yip. I held my breath and listened. At last I said, "It's just an old coyote, isn't it?" I whispered. Father said, "Yes, just a coyote." I listened again, and I said, "I'm big enough to shoot a coyote."
"Mm-hmm."
I lay stiff and tense. The coyote kept on yipping. Then I began to relax. That was the last I remembered. The sun wakened us, streaming in the open end of the lean-to. The air was chilly. Outside, just down the slope, two meadowlarks were singing, trying to outdo each other. I sat up and listened, then kicked the blankets off. Off of Father, too. He opened his eyes and growled, but I knew it wasn't a scolding growl. I laughed, and he grabbed me and began to wallow and tousle me. We made a rat's nest of the bed, and then Father rolled me right out into the cold, wet grass. After the first wet surprise, it felt good. I shouted and leaped and flapped my arms and crowed at the sun like a rooster. I ran down into the blue stem and back, my underdrawers flapping around my legs, breathless. Father was tucking his shirt into his overalls. He grabbed me and carried me, squealing, under his arm to the buffalo wallow. But he didn't duck me. We washed our faces in the cold, clear water,
and I ran back and dressed while Father built a fire and mixed pancake batter. I hobbled the horses and turned them loose to graze, and we ate breakfast. We floored the house and we put shiplap lumber on the walls, leaving gaps for the door and windows. We put up rafters for a curved roof that made the cabin look like a squat railroad car. And the night we got half the roof boards on, we moved inside. We finished the roof, put on roofing paper, and framed the doors and the windows. It was just a shell of a house, but Father planned to lay up sod around it and put sod on the roof for winter warmth and summer coolness. And the night we finished the roof, I made my own separate pallet of blankets. So we had a house. It had no door and no window sash, but it was a house. Our house. Then we dug the well. Father chose the site, just down the slope from the house at the edge of the draw. We moved the wagon to the place, and Father bored a hole with the post-hole auger. He went down 4 feet, as deep as he could go, a hole 8 inches across. Then he unscrewed the handle from the auger, put on an 8-foot length of pipe, put the handle on again, and had an auger 12 feet long. By standing on the wagon bed, he could go on digging with it. We had to lift the auger every time it filled, and I emptied it. Then Father put it down the hole again and went down another auger length. We went down and down, a foot at a time, and the pile of soil beside the well became bigger and bigger. At first, the soil the auger brought up was brown. Then it was fine yellow clay. We were still in the yellow clay, but we were down almost 12 feet at the end of the first day's digging. The next morning, we put on another length of pipe and started on down. It was slow going because we had to lift all that length of pipe every time we had an auger full. We had gone down only about 4 more feet by mid-morning when we saw a bay team and a spring wagon down in Ketchum Holler. The team turned and came up our draw. A big red-faced man was driving. He had 2 big rough-coated dogs in the spring wagon with him. And alongside, trotting in the grass, were 4 long-legged hounds, dark-coated and sleek-tailed, as though they had greyhound blood. The man drove up beside us, and the hounds came and sniffed at me. The man said, "Hello," in a deep, gruff voice. Father greeted him, and the man said, "Homesteader?" "Yes," Father said. "I've taken the north half of Section 17 here." "I'm John Garrity," the man said. "My camp down there." And he waved a hand toward the windmill in the hollow.
"Got water yet?"
"Not yet."
Garrity smiled.
"Likely you won't. Water's spotty in this country. If you do get it, it won't be good water, and it'll dry up in a dry summer. This land's good for nothing but grazing. You won't stay."
"Maybe not," Father said, "but we'll sure try."
Garrity smiled. "They come and they go. Maybe you notice this country is still pretty vacant."
"I noticed there was lots of room," Father said.
"Good country," Garrity said, "for coyotes and jackrabbits and sheep. You'll find out."
He gathered his reins and called to his hounds.
"I'm running coyotes today," he said, "cleaning up the range before I put the sheep out."
He looked at the well again and shook his head. Then he turned his team and drove back down the draw. John Garrity had come to Colorado 20 years before, a young laborer working for the railroad. He was a big man, a tough man. He had plenty of tough company in the railroad crews of that day. But whereas the others were content to lay ties and spike rails all day and drink and fight in resounding brawls most of the night, John Garrity had a gnawing personal ambition. He was going to get ahead. He saw opportunity in this raw new country. He didn't know what he was going to do, but he knew he wasn't going to be a pick and shovel man all his life. He quit the railroad and took a job as a roustabout in a livery stable. There he listened to the casual talk of the cattlemen who came to town, and he began to understand things about this short grass country that he had only vaguely sensed before. he began to see where he wanted to go. This was grass country, a land of free grass. The man who moved in and took that grass, and was strong enough to hold it, became a cattle baron. Once you had a range, you could buy cheap cattle in Texas or in Mexico, trail them north, fatten them on the grass, and sell them at a most satisfying profit. There were various ways to get the range. It was government land, widely conceded to be of no value except for grazing. Technically, it was open to anyone who would homestead it. Practically, it was not considered farmland and hence not desirable homestead land. The farmer of that day would not give it a second look. So, by forfeit and economic practicality, it was left to the ranchmen to use it as they would. A ranch generally started with a homestead at a strategic point, a place where there was natural water, a stream, or a pond. Since water was scarce, if you controlled the water, you controlled all the grass for miles around. So the ranchman homesteaded and took title to a home place with water on it. Then he persuaded a few of his chosen cowboys to homestead the other strategic plots on his range. As soon as they proved up on those plots, they sold them to the ranchman for a few hundred dollars. Thus, by owning a few hundred acres and controlling the water, the ranchman came to control thousands of acres of grass. These things John Garrity learned, and he planned ahead to the time when he, too, would be a cattle baron. But chance and weather changed his plans. A drought struck in New Mexico on the sheep ranges. Desperate sheepmen shipped their flocks north, looking for grass or buyers. John Garrity, a provident man, had a few hundred dollars. Hearing about the grass-starved sheep, he went to Denver and bought all the sheep he could get for cash and credit, a flock of 500 head. He knew little or nothing about sheep management, but he had a knack with animals, and he had this driving ambition. He had his sheep delivered to a way station east of Denver, unloaded them, and took to the hills with them. All that summer, John Garrity, with nothing but a bedroll on his back and a rifle in his hands, roamed the hills with his flock. He fought off the coyotes, avoided the major cattle ranges, and somehow pulled more than 400 head of that flock through the summer. He had them sheared on shares and made a few hundred dollars from the wool. And that fall, he drove them to market and sold them for four times what he had paid. John Garrity was in business. He spent that winter looking for range he could appropriate. He found the place he wanted in Ketchum Holler, an area that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.